Take your time, move slowly into your space. Make sure you've got a drink, make sure you've eaten. I just want to introduce myself. I'm Sonna Matani, I'm the Chief Executive of the Selby Trust. And I'd like to thank you all for joining us today. Very important day for us as a community centre within Harrogate. And we've set up this kind of power to vote campaign ourselves. It's a long-standing agenda of ours to get our citizens to sign up and be registered to vote. And we are conscious that many people within Harrogate are not registered. So we thought we would talk to all the other community organisations in our networks and spread the word and try and build on a little movement to get this job done, if you like, so that for the forthcoming elections and forever afterwards, for every election that ever takes place in Britain, we're in a state of readiness. It's got a particular focus around black and ethnic minority communities, which I'll go into in the course of the presentation. So that's kind of why we're here, and it's great to see, in true Harrogate style, a real mix of people here. Councillors, local residents, community groups. And I know our local MPs are on their way. Just wanted to give you a bit of insight into the Selby Centre. We've, you know, put all our publicity on your chairs and everything. And it's probably somewhere you might have heard of in the past, or you might not have, I don't know. Has everyone been to Selby before, or not really? No? It's always changing as a place, but we have about 100 community groups, charities, social enterprises, many, many organisations that have been resident-formed, resident-led, and many have survived all through the decades through recessions and all kinds of turbulence and are still here. And also we've got quite a few new ones as well coming on board. I can see Robin there from Havco, and they're running a project with us about if you want to develop a new project, how to go about it. So there's always new things in the pipeline. I myself was a volunteer once upon a time, unemployed graduate, trying to get some work experience from anyone who will give it to me, and I popped up at the Selby Centre, and one of the organisations here built my confidence, those classic things, and I launched myself on the world better equipped. About 10 years later I came back to be a project worker. I worked on some capacity building projects. And again, Selby was a great place to gain that knowledge experience. And so it's a real privilege now to have come back again and be the chief exec. This place is a real team operation in partnership with many of the groups that are based here, as well as our staff and our volunteers. This year is our 30th year, and which is no mean feat. You know, we're trying to do middle age now, and, you know, finances are tight, charities are under pressure, but Selby's generating about 75% of its own income. And regularly, local residents are doing their thing here, accessing advice, support, but also running affairs, if you like. Coming now to the BME vote, which is what we've kind of framed this session around. About 18% of BME residents in Harrogate are not registered to vote, and Africans in particular are being highlighted as the least likely to register. 28% of African communities not registering. In Tottenham, we've got sizeable BME populations, 49% in Tottenham, and in Hornsey and Wood Green, almost 30%. And of course, if you don't register, your voice isn't going to be heard, is it, at the ballot box? When you've got an issue, it's harder to find that councillor on the phone. They don't know who you are, you're not connected in, you're not part of that network. So this is something that is of concern to us, particularly given that our motto at Selby is many cultures, one community, and that's something that really needs to be addressed. And certainly, you know, language barriers, people not feeling familiar with the system, you know, often remembering perhaps places that they come from where engagement with institutions is not something that you do easily. It's not something you're going to be rewarded for. And on top of that, the registration system itself has changed. So the system now is that each person who lives within a household has to register. It's not just the main person in the house who signs for everybody else. And so each and every single person has to sign up. It's available online, and online's great for some of us, but I know you've all got your Twitter accounts. But some people are not comfortable with that yet, and we still need to do a lot of work around digital inclusion. In terms of disengagement with the political system, well, that is very prevalent. And of course, in terms of diversity, it's improved, but it's not anywhere near where it needs to be. So these are some of the things that we see as issues that need to be tackled to help solve this problem. We know that even though we've got all these groups within our network and that we're a strong organisation, we can't do this on our own, hence inviting you to help us with some of that. However, what we've done is house a lot of organisations here who can help chip away at some of those barriers. So language, access to computers, knowledge of the system. These are some of the things we're happy to take on. And we've got quite a lot of pledges from local organisations about the sorts of things that they're going to do with us. So many community centres are signing up alongside with us. So, and we're recruiting more all the time. So, and we really need your help to get the word out there. So I'm hoping that after today's meeting, each one of us can actually do something. And I know I've got some volunteers in the crowd there. I'm going to call on one of them. Ilyas, can you just say a few words, introduce yourself?
Yes. Hi, my name is...
To the side a bit. Brilliant. You bring on the good-looking people, aren't you?
Hello, I'm Ilyas Osman. Thank you. I'm one of the organizations that have a business in Selby Centre. I just registered myself to vote. I've been here 20 years. And the three bullet points you just raised regarding the, I don't have any of these three barriers, and I didn't know what was making me hold back. So. I know how to use computers.
Yeah.
I understand the political system. But I just thought nobody in the political system would represent my views, and therefore I was always not so much involved in the political system.
So do you feel like a changed man?
Yes.
Yes?
Yeah, finally.
So you offered me some help.
Yes, I would help you with the three.
Yeah.
Inhabitants.
Yes, so we have quite a large Somali population in the borough, and we are wanting to encourage them to sign up.
Well, I speak so highly Arabic and Somali, so anywhere from these communities, I'll be able to help.
Thank you very much. Hi. So. We've got all our community groups here, but also off-site. Selby has been part of setting up a network of community centres. So we've joined up with others, and more are keen to join as well. The Asian Centre in Wood Green, represented here.
Hi.
Yeah, Eleanor.
Hi.
And Hornsey Vale. There's another organisation called the Ubaili Initiative, and Community Builders. And Haringey's community organisers that are based here in Haringey and at Selby.
Centre.
Pardon?
We haven't got the Irish.
I know, I'm looking for the Irish Centre to join up. And if the Irish Centre wants to, we're very keen for them to do so. So All comers welcome, because we've got to have that on the ground network talking to each other to make this happen. The important thing is to really do that outreach. And what we found is our networks into mosques, into churches, and at community events, this stuff works because it's face to face. We'll have a laptop there, we can get people to engage straight away. We do know that at the moment of registration, somebody does need to have their NI number with them, you know, so we don't want that to hold things up. But as Ilias mentioned, you know, language, there's lots of people around who can translate. We want to be able to overcome that. Also, on site, we'll be having a regular stall. So, for example, next Friday, we have a regular prayer meeting upstairs, and as people leave, they'll already have our flyer saying, come on down next Friday, fully expect that you'll spend 5 or 10 minutes and it'll be done. So we want to see, we'll be setting ourselves targets and all the rest of it. And we're very lucky here at Selby because we've got Seema, who is a marketing machine all by herself, and we need to support her effort. The brilliant thing now with technology is you can even, I could record Ilias speaking in Arabic and I can put that out on the internet and signpost people to that link and text people that link. Whatever the medium is, people feel comfortable with it. We have to be, you know, that flexible blob that fits in with their lives. So we're happy to do that. The other brilliant thing about many cultures, one community, is we aren't particularly being party political about this, you know. That's an irrelevance for us as a charity. We just want people to register, irrespective of how they're going to vote. That's up to them. That's their personal decision. So it's fantastic to see the whole spread across the political spectrum here today. This is on the back of all the previous hustings events that we've done, and we're looking forward to this year's as well. So great to see you here. And look who's come. Look who's chilling out in the back there. So welcome, David. Let me hand over to you. Great to see you. Welcome back to Selby. Kept it nice and warm.
Thank you.
I'm hungry, I'm getting another snack.
Well, congratulations to you for having this event and for driving this forward. And for making it cross-party. I think that for a number of reasons it's important in our area. First is, all of you know that we have lots of houses of multiple occupation, we have lots of transients, we have lots of people in the London Borough of Haringey who move through the London Borough of Haringey because it is a gateway community, but move out of it as well. We have many, many folk across the borough for whom, because of the pressures in their own lives, voting is not the number one thing on their agenda, actually. They do, you know, I imagine a lot of us in this room are very, very politically engaged, are, you know, news hawks, but actually, average Joe Bloggs in Haringey is not. The news is something that happens occasionally. You are busy getting on with, you know, raising the kids, putting food on the table, going out to work, most often shift work. There are lots and lots of reasons why, even though politics matters in their lives, people are not fully politically engaged. There are decisions made by successive governments that affect everyone's lives in this constituency. And we want to ensure that that franchise that, you know, people fought very hard to get for working men and women, for women, and indeed for ethnic minorities, is extended and reaches everybody. This is a time of change, actually, the burden of registration feels like a burden if you've got to have a national insurance number and some of the logistics to go with it, but I want that drive. And there is nothing more disheartening than being the local member of parliament. And when it comes to who gets the resources, finding that there are people not on the register, that the population count for London Borough of Haringey, that the perspective on deprivation, either in Tottenham or Green or wherever, all of these things is lower than they should be because we actually haven't got those registered. And indeed, and it's in the news today, last time round on the Boundary Commission, many of us could not believe that the result or conclusion of the Boundary Commission was that we should tear Tottenham in half. And that was largely because it wasn't deemed that we had the population that merited it remaining an entire constituency, when many of us know that there are many, many people in Tottenham of voting age, and of course it merits being a whole constituency. That happened just a few years ago and could well happen again. So for all of those reasons, it's important to encourage folk to register, to get the word out, to go street to street, but more often than not, institution to institution, grassroots institutions and networks, reminding people that they really, really lose out if we don't have those numbers and if they aren't able to participate. The whole point of having a participatory democracy is that people can participate, and this is a time when I think being shut out of those debates, well, frankly, it's not palatable because there are so many things coming out of government, particularly and central and local government, that affect people's lives. So very pleased to support the Selby, very pleased to support this initiative. We need my voters, my electors, but actually beyond that, all electors registered.
Thank you, David. We're going to move on to speak, hear Jerome Francis speak. He's from the Haringey Green Party. Can we have a round of applause for Jerome?
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jerome Francis. I'm representing the Haringey Green Party. I'm just going to go quickly through why we don't vote and why we should vote and why I particularly chose the Green Party. So if there's a prime example of how disenfranchised a lot of black and ethnic minority people are feeling currently with the political climate, it's my parents. Now, my dad moved here when he was 11 years old, originally from Jamaica. My mum was born in North Mid Hospital, same as me, down the road. She's a first generation black woman. They're both in their 50s now. They won't appreciate me saying that, but they are. But my mum even worked in a polling station at the last general election. So I asked her who she voted for. She said, I couldn't be bothered. I said, Mum, you worked in a polling station. She said, well, the two main parties were bickering amongst each other. No one spoke about policy. They were too busy shouting each other down, saying who's worse than the other. And my dad has similar sentiment as well. And these are people who have voted several times before. So that's one generation. Then you have me. I'm 30 years old. I've actually moved back home because the rent is too much in my own city that I'm born in. I can't afford to rent and work. And I've worked for some of the biggest companies in the UK. And then you have the youngest generation coming up. They've seen cuts to their education services, cuts to child funds, and their university fees tripled. So you've got three generations disenfranchised, and this disproportionately hits black and ethnic minority people. And it's understandable why people don't vote, but it's for those very reasons why we should be voting. And we shouldn't be protest voting and not voting, because other communities protest vote and vote for parties such as UKIP, and that's why you get their rise. So it's very important to make sure you're registered and voting. I particularly chose the Green Party because it felt like they resonated with me. They've been championing a living wage long before the other parties did so. They've been championing equality in the workplace and socially long before other parties. We currently have Tottenham going the same way as other London boroughs with its gentrification plans. And places like Broadwater Farm, where I had friends growing up, described as sinkholes by other people. And the Green Party is against that. Sean Berry's put out plans to improve estates whilst keeping communities together, and I think that's very important. So that's why it resonated with me. So regardless of whatever party you resonate with, it's still important to find someone to vote for. And I'd like to say another problem is our housing and our rent, which I spoke about earlier. At the moment, we're the only party which is putting forward a London Renters Union, which Sean Berry has put forward, which will help us to get rid of rogue letting agents. Many of us feel that our rents are being hiked up and we've been pushed out without much rights. And I feel that it's important that we make sure our voices is heard on this, because it is disproportionately black and ethnic minority people who are suffering because of this. So why can our vote actually make a difference? Well, I'd like to quote Simon Woolley from a group called Operation Blackfire, and I want to quote him properly, so I'm just going to read. In Hornsey and Wood Green, the BME electorate is 26,406 people, which is larger than the seat was won by, 6,875. So there is your answer. There is our answer. We are a block of 26,000 people. That if we continue to vote, if we consistently voted, MPs would start to listen to us. That's a block of 26,000 people. So it's important to understand that even though you feel like you're one vote, we all each get one vote. We're as powerful as each other. And it's important to continually vote, continually make sure that your friends and family are registered so your voice is being heard. And lastly, I just want to say, I want us to all remember why we are here and how we have the luxury not to vote. Women went through a lot of struggles to get the vote. Black people went through a lot of struggles and bloodshed to get the vote. We're very lucky that because of our forefathers, we are able to be here and we have the right to not vote. But is that what they wanted? If they could see us now, is that what they wanted? I don't think so. So I think we should not forget that. And I think we should all stick together and make sure whatever party you do choose, you find someone that resonates with you and you do vote. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Gerald. Can I say that we are a charity, so we are really careful about giving platforms during election time. So the next set of people that come up, from whatever party it is, if we can just resist it. We're having a hustings on the 20th. We have a boxing ring on site. It's all going down. We've got it all prepared for the 20th. But if we can just bear in mind that this is not a party political sort of thing, this is actually a cross party thing, that would be great. But thank you very much, Joelle. We're now going to invite Philip Bidet, who is conveniently taking his jacket off. Everyone's staring because he's late. Philip is from an organisation called Community Builders, and he's one of the partners on this project. And he doesn't realise that I'm trying to talk to wait for him to come up, so he's actually waiting for me to finish. And he's one of our partners, and he's going to explain why, when we asked him to be involved, he said, "Of course I'm going to be involved." Like, well, something like that, wasn't it?
Yes, something like
that. So, can we give a round of applause for Philip?
Thank you, everyone. Sorry to join you late. I've spent my week in Berlin, and anyway, I've had a very busy week. I got married last weekend. Got a ring. I don't know if I'm wearing it on the right hand, but it definitely it wobbles around too much on the other hand. Anyway, so I guess the theme of this event is really about the power to vote. I run a social enterprise based in Tottenham, which is at the 639. Enterprise Centre. I'm also a board member. There, and our aim there is about encouraging young people to get involved in businesses and to be part of startups. And for me, growing up in Tottenham and living here and running a social enterprise here. Actually, I think part of the power to vote is partly about economic power. And I think actually a lot of people are disempowered and disenfranchised economically, which actually is part of people being disenfranchised and disempowered politically. And so how do we address these type of issues? I can't say I'm going to give you a solution, but I can maybe give an insight based on a project that we've been running recently. This project has been run in partnership with Business in the Community, who are about partnering city businesses and local businesses to come together to help provide solutions and positive initiatives in the community. And so what we've done is we recruited and trained up a group of five volunteers who actually, some of them helpfully came from SONA here at the Selby Centre. And actually these five people went out into the community and they were actually paid to go out and conduct questionnaires looking at the underlying causes of unemployment in Tottenham. And so what they found is that actually there's a whole range of issues around people facing barriers around travel and how to get into the certain centres where work exists, skills barriers and skills gaps, language barriers and language gaps. You know, people on the whole, and I hope I'm not going to offend anybody, felt that Job Centre Plus was really failing, So they felt that they could only go there to be processed and to, you know, have their papers stamped for them to get their benefits.
But in reality,
sorry?
I second that.
Okay, thank you. But part, you know, Job Centre Plus needs to be part of any solutions that we put together. And actually, we're doing some work to bring a group of businesses, including Stansted Airport, who have got hundreds of jobs going every month, and people from Tottenham are just not applying because there's a perception that actually these jobs are too far away, or they're too much on sociable hours, or, you know, there are certain barriers, and actually these barriers are not necessarily real, but a lot of people are opting out of you know, really tangible opportunities and economic opportunities for themselves to progress. So there's an economic barrier, and I feel that actually our communities, when we talk about BME communities, we need to talk about communities becoming politicized with a small p. So not necessarily Green or Labour or Lib Dems, but actually how do we get people actually taking responsibility and feeling a sense of empowerment in their own communities to get involved and to actually make their voices heard. So part of the way that I do this is through the Our Tottenham Network. Some of you I know have been involved and come to meetings. But actually what we find is that when we're talking about issues like demolition, of places like Northumberland Park, where a great deal of the social housing is going to be demolished and rebuilt, which will actually result in some level of displacement of individuals. And the worst affected groups will be black groups, particularly black females from the council's own impact assessment. But actually these people are not coming to meetings. They're not coming to the meetings of Haringey Defence, Council Housing, or Our Tottenham. So even on a grassroots level, we're not talking about political with a capital P. We're not the Labour Party or Green Party or Lib Dems, but actually on a grassroots level, BME groups are not always engaging. And we need to find out why. Possibly even if we look around the room, perhaps we'll find that also maybe we may slightly be underrepresented perhaps, which is difficult to do in the Selby Centre actually. But actually this room may well not be fully representative of Tottenham, of the local community. So, you know, these are things we need to address, and we need to look at it, and we need to think about how do we become more inclusive. It's not something that can be dropped down on top of people, but actually it's really important. And for me, I'll just note just maybe one of our consequences perhaps, or one of the issues that arise from political disengagement is, I recently read a statistic that since 1990, 509 BME refugee and migrant deaths have occurred in police custody, prisons, and immigration removal centers. And no convictions have been made despite several verdicts of unlawful killing. So, for me, what we need is not just politics with a capital P, but actually we need grassroots engagement. We need people to feel empowered to make their voices heard. And then hopefully what we can do through that is we can actually have politicians who then become accountable. It's not just about the number of BME or black faces within the political establishment or within government, but actually how are these politicians made to feel accountable to the black community? And maybe the economics is a strong part of it. If we can get people starting their own businesses, starting their own enterprise, creating jobs, then actually these people's voices become much more powerful and much more hopefully important and interesting to politicians and lawmakers who will have to listen. So that's all from me. I'll leave it there. Thank you very much.
Actually do quite a YouTube videos and takes that last about 3 hours if you ever want to. I'm so nervous that we were trying to condense them down to 5 minutes, but it's done. I'm really proud. Can I now invite Joanne McCartney, who is the GLA Assembly Member for Enfield and Harringay, have I got that right?
Yeah.
I have. To come up and talk about why she feels that the BAME vote is so important for London, I guess.
Yeah.
So I start by saying that I'm delighted to be here and thanking the Selby Centre and Sana and Seema for organising this, because it is very important that people not only register to vote but actually use their vote as well once they're registered. I mean, I've just come from a door knocking session this morning up in Edmonton, and so many people not aware there's an election on. We all here are political, can't quite understand why people don't realise there's an election on. But they go, well, I might vote, I might not vote. But when you actually talk to them and explain why it is important for them to vote, you know, that message does get through. So I think the more we can talk to people and to various communities, that's very helpful. And of course, the next election is the London elections. And they are important because, as Philip has just so eloquently told us, many BME people look at issues that affect them or disproportionately affect them, such as poor housing, such as poverty, and such as access to skills and jobs. And they are all those issues, actually, that will be affected by this London election and who you elect as your mayor and assembly members, because the mayor has powers to change a lot in those issues. So whoever you're voting for, be aware that this is an important election. And of course, London is the most diverse place in the country. You know, we are the foremost world city. All the world is here. And the diversity of this borough, Harringay, is changing as well, as it has always changed. You know, we had our Somali speaker earlier, a growing Somali population. And as we know, here, a growing Eastern European population as well, all entitled to vote. So it's important that we engage with those communities. And I know that from when I go out speaking to local people on a weekly basis, that actually having people in our team that can speak those different languages and truly engage with people on the doorstep is really important. I also want to pick up something that Philip talked about, which was about the responsibility of politicians, because I am an elected member, and I am aware that as a woman, I'm underrepresented still in politics, but we've made a lot of headway, particularly in my party on that, but not good enough. We've made headway on BME representation, as have other parties, but certainly not good enough. And so I think, you know, if we to engage people, people need to look at politicians and see people they that actually reflect them, reflect their values, and reflect their background and can understand where they are coming from. So I think it is a responsibility. And it's also important that we actually engage and we listen. Because if we encourage people to vote, they need to know that actually if they do vote for me or for other people, then actually we're going to make a difference and be brave to tackle issues that might not be comfortable in our work. So, you know, tackling things like, why is it that
members, particularly young black boys are disproportionately stopped and searched on our streets. Why is it that the only young men in particular are disproportionately represented in our criminal justice system? I know David's doing some important work on that over the next few months. Why is it that BAME chances at educational achievement and access to jobs are disproportionately poorer? And they are all issues that as politicians we have a responsibility to actually address, to question and to take action on, and to hold people to account, just as you hold us to account. I'm going to want to stop it there. I think that's just a flavour of why it's important that not only we register people to vote, but we encourage people to vote, and that we encourage those people, if they can get engaged, and they want to get engaged, to actually get involved, not only in their community politics, but actually leading their community to an elected position as well. So thank you.
According to Mark, this is Beth, by the way, she's a young person who's volunteering and helped put all this together. So according to our control freak list, we're running a minute behind. I can't believe it, Tottenham. So can I just now invite Dawn Barnes from the Haringey Lib Dems up to talk about why the BAME vote is important in her perspective, but also from the Lib Dem perspective.
Thank you.
And please clap.
Thank you for organising this event. It's not just the BAME vote that's important, it's everybody's vote. But I'm just going to start with a little story from Monday evening this week. It's partly why I was able to be here today, because I was working extra late, so I got half a day today. I work for a university at the moment, for King's College London. I'm an e-student recruitment for them. And we have a very diverse university population, but I went to a school on Monday to talk to students there who were thinking about going to university about the competitive admissions process. Because King's is one of those that sets these ridiculous standards, and I don't know how the students actually get the grades. And I spoke to a young woman, a young black woman, who came over to talk to me, and she said she wanted to go into aerospace engineering. We don't do that at King's. And the really sad thing that went through my mind, and this is what it says a lot about our society really, is that she wants to do engineering, women don't do engineering, we're desperate, and she's a black woman. So I wanted to help her anyway, but I think she'd be wonderful. She could be putting people in space soon. Fortunately, one of my friends, unbelievably, actually puts people into space for a living, and he went to Leicester. So I said, I'm so sorry, my university isn't for you. I'm going to be sacked. I think Leicester might be somewhere you might consider. I'm sure there are others. And so I put her into contact with my friend who does it for a job. And maybe one day she'll choose that as a career option. But the thing is that I was thinking, engineering, women and black people don't do that so much. And that's a really sad way to be. And it's really important that we all do vote. As Joanne said, there's not very many women elected, or not as many as we'd like. The Liberal Democrats, sadly, have 8 white men elected to Parliament. I do apologise to the white men in the room if I offend you with my dislike of white men, but you do seem to have all the power, and it is very disappointing for the rest of us, to be quite honest. We have views as well. I would love to see more elected people across councils and parliaments and London who aren't just former lawyers and bankers and doctors, but are plumbers and hairdressers and everything else as well. Really representing all of our people. In the Liberal Democrats, particularly with our woeful attempts at diversity of late, especially in Parliament, our new leader would like us to have 50% of future target parliamentary seats with women candidates, and 10% of our future target seats with black, Asian and minority ethnic people in place. Hopefully they'll get elected. Part of that is up to the voters, which is why you must register to vote and make sure you have your say in who is and isn't elected. One of the things I've done, I'm also on the Federal Executive, which is this kind of board that oversees the running of the Liberal Democrats, and I want to see more people from more diverse backgrounds being selected to stand for various things, including the London Assembly, which has a partly proportional representational system, which apparently favours women and other candidates less likely to win. But it's to get shortlists of all underrepresented candidates for the Liberal Democrats. Now, apparently, the Equalities Act doesn't allow for this, so I'm hitting a brick wall, but for the future, the idea would be that you would have shortlists that are all underrepresented groups, which could possibly mean, in a distant future, hopefully not too distant, that white men may be allowed on that list because perhaps one day they won't be represented quite as strongly as they are now, and it would be more about balance and equalities, which is something I'm passionate about. Locally, unfortunately today, Ter Hanosen, who stood for Tottenham for the Liberal Democrats in the last election, couldn't be here because he has to work. And he has done quite a lot of work with Turkish people because that's his background, he speaks the language and has the links. But it is about us, and it is us in this room here today, getting out and using the skills and the languages and the links that we have to try and say there is a reason to get involved in politics and find what that reason might be. I listened to Jarrell, who was telling me about the disenfranchisement of his parents and almost himself, but happily he's voting now. And it's really important that we do speak to people, and young people are another key target. So on the basis that young people aren't voting so much, and women are 50% of the overall community, the overall population, and we can assume the same for BAME votes, we need to get out there, we need to speak to people, we need to engage with them, we need to interest them. And to be honest, I'd rather they voted Lib Dem, but if they go and vote, that'll do for me. So go out and speak with our local communities. We know what we need to do, so let's do it. I'm now going to invite Eleanor Harding from the Asian Centre, who is also one of our partners. If I'm not mistaken, no offence to it, but actually the Asian Centre responded faster than you to the email to the partnership. And it's quite great news because obviously it's on the other side of the bar, it's in the green, and it targets, I guess, an older population as well, I guess, who are actually finding it quite hard to engage with this new voting system online. And maybe not be able to engage with that. So I'll leave the rest of it to Eleanor. Clap.
Thank you. Everybody has said things that I think are true, and I think that we all agree with them. And so what I will hope to mention briefly here is an optimistic picture for 2016, because I think it's a really exciting year when it comes to voting. I work at the Asian Centre. I have been there now for 3 or 4 months, so I can't claim to be an expert in the huge diversity of people's experiences who come to that centre. I also, this morning, in a different role, spent 3 hours with sixth form girls at Grieve City Academy, which is a school in Hornsey, 97% BAME, and talking about power and what women can do to counter the world of stereotyping and underrepresentation that they see, and not just women, of course, but BAME women, which is even more stereotyped and underrepresented. So I'm really in the mode right now of thinking about how do we as individuals actually have power. And I think speaking to that point about disengagement with politics, which is something that sometimes feels like we can't do that much about it, that that's going to be an issue for the powers that be to make changes in our electoral system, 2016 is a really great year because we have two elections coming up where, as individuals, we count. We really count because they're not first past the post, because they're not semi-proportional representation, which means that still we see the same parties coming out again and again and again. So we've got the May elections coming up where the London Assembly is almost half proportional representation. I campaign for the Women's Equality Party, as one that hasn't got mentioned just yet, but we're going out and when we're talking to people, we're not only having to say, by the way, did you know there's a Women's Equality Party, because it's quite a new thing, but we're also having to say, and you know what, it's worth voting for a minority party this time round, because we only need about 100,000 votes across the whole of London to get a London Assembly a member through the PR bit of the, through the London-wide selection process. So that's a really amazing thing to be able to say if you are one of these 100,000, then you've done it. And there isn't any, like, you don't lose out, you know, if you put yourself forward to say, what this person wants to be elected, then you may very well see them there, and every vote that we get counts. Then, of course, we're also probably going to have a European referendum coming up at some point this year. Again, every vote there will count because it's just a yes or a no. And so, and these are, like, the EU issue is one that hugely affects all of us in lots of different ways, and I think especially BAME communities, because their voices aren't represented through the mainstream political people who are having conversations at the high level, which means that as individuals, again, they need to be putting, we need to be putting our voices forward. So I would just say that is one of, 2016 is a great year for us to be going out and saying sign up, because it's one of the only years where we can say, because if you sign up to vote, it actually makes a difference. That's that.
Thank you, Eleanor. I'm now going to introduce a dear friend of mine. Did I spell your name wrong? I knew it. There had to be something, didn't there?
You could be a Haringey teacher.
Oh. Come up here, Justin. Can I introduce you to Justin, who's the chairman of the Tottenham Conservatives, who doesn't spell his name like that, and I've purposely done it just so that you can see it. And, but I'm now going to hand over to him about why the BAME vote is important to the Conservatives, not just in Tottenham, but in general.
Okay, thank you. Well, the previous speakers have been very impressive, so it's fairly obvious it's there, it's a hard act to follow. I'd like to start by thanking the Selby Centre for inviting all of us here today, and on behalf of the Conservative Party, you can be sure that we support this initiative. Whenever we go campaigning in Tottenham, we take voter registration forms, and we give them to people who are undecided, and the probabilities are they are not going to vote for us. But that is irrelevant. I'd also like to pay tribute to Operation Black Vote, which was founded in 1996 to ensure racial equality, boosting participation in the democratic institutions. Before that, Charter 88 and a collection of individuals and small organisations, often working behind the scenes, doing their bit to ensure change and equality. In the Conservatives, in the 80s and 90s, we had the One Nation Forum. In Labour, they had the Black Section, now BAME Labour. It is important to remember previous campaigners and acknowledge their struggles and successes. Prime Minister David Cameron is to be congratulated for appointing David Lammy to head up an important review into terrible injustices in our criminal justice system. As David himself put it, if you are a black person, you are more likely to be in a prison cell than at a top university. And we all know about the shocking statistics regarding stop and search. There is a huge amount of work to be done, and we wish him well with it. And I'd just like to add that I think it was very brave of David to take up this appointment, because there'll be many in his own party who will be downright hostile to a Labour MP taking up the Tory challenge to ensure equality and justice in our criminal justice system. The first Asian MP was elected in 1982. He sat for Bethnal Green, and he was a Liberal. They only have seven more now than they had then. But we had to wait until 1987 before we saw an obvious increase in black and minority representation. And in 1987, almost a century on, Keith Vaz was elected with Diane Abbott and, of course, Bernie Grant. Bernie Grant, of course, nearly didn't get elected in 1987, the Labour majority here in Tottenham was cut to just 4,000. But thanks to people like Sheila and other comrades, we were deprived of an opportunity of representation. The last time we had an MP here, of course, was 1935, in the Tottenham North constituency. I'm very proud of the progress that the Conservative Party has made in Parliament. We now have more black and Asian MPs than Labour, I think, or at least on an equal footing. David must have been very surprised going back to Parliament after May and seeing all these new shiny, colourful, quite literally, faces on the green benches. And that's something, even if you're not a Conservative, you should praise. The elections are coming up in May. They are important, and we do need to maximise turnout. Unfortunately, many people, regardless of party, tell us there's no point in voting. If you're Labour, there's no point in voting because the current MP has a 20,000 majority. If you're a Conservative, Lib Dem, Green, or Respect, whatever they're called now, there's no point in voting because the Labour MP has a 20,000 majority. And it seems to me we need to change the voting system to ensure that our voices, and that includes the 6,000 people who voted Conservative in Tottenham, are adequately and properly represented on our councils and in Parliament. Finally, I would just like to wish you the best of luck with this initiative. And as I said earlier, you are assured of our support. And it's great to see so many political friends and foes here. And of course, the reason I am here is because the 1992 general election, I was a kid at a certain primary school in Seven Sisters, and I remember the head teacher of that school randomly coming up to me and putting a Vote Labour sticker on me. And I said, I wasn't Labour, I hadn't even a clue what the Labour Party was, I didn't know anything about politics, but I said her, I said I was a Tory just to spite her, and I kept it up, so thank you very much.
Because I am pleased because there's still so much food left behind, including loads of that Turkish, I can't say the word, but we keep doing this.
Pizza.
But before we get to the food, we want to introduce Kevin West MP from Hornsey and Wood Green, who hopefully I have spelled your name right. And this is, I guess, quite important for us because I guess we've got a lot of the organisations that are coming forward that have been in the Tottenham area. We've got Hornsey Vale now and the Asian Centre, and we're kind of working towards getting organisations in the west of the borough. So hopefully your endorsement of this project will assist with that. So if we can have a round of applause for Kathy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Seymour. That's really lovely to be here. Nice to see some people who I only normally see on Twitter. Thank you. That's nice to meet you. And it's always good to be at the Selby Centre, which is such a great example of being at the heart of the community and to be with friends from across the board. I wanted to say two things. The first thing is to just talk about really what gets people out to vote. And I think that's about what are the policies that we actually want to introduce in any election. And I've always been a big person in favour of housing and making housing affordable, and I think it's very much up the agenda. I think possibly having my origins in a slightly more inner city environment to begin with, it was already on the agenda very much way back in sort of elections that I was involved in way back in 2002, 2006, those sorts of times. But now across all of London, because there was a time, wasn't there, where Tottenham was considered affordable. And of course these days, now, to rent in Turnpike Lane, you need an income of £60,000 per annum. And that really is just what we do politics for, to try and make a difference, to try and introduce policies which can give people an opportunity, because really the message about representation of any underrepresented groups is how do we provide opportunity? And in London, what you need to be able to do is have a roof over your head. And that really is why the whole question of affordable housing is so high up the agenda in the mayoral election, and in any election in London, I think. It's having that security that allows you to go forward. And I think security is a really big question at the moment in politics in general. That's for everybody, be that through having a secure place in a school. You know, we've got a teacher recruitment crisis at the moment and school places crisis a bit in London. We've got huge questions around housing and also around jobs and what kind of jobs. So for example, the big announcements in the last few months about housing have all been about how everybody can afford to buy a house. The government's going to help you to buy a house. The trouble is that to buy a house you need a mortgage, and to buy a have a mortgage you need, don't you, to have the kind of job that a bank will give you a mortgage for. And we know that if you're in minimum wage or insecure, those short-term contracts for work, it's going to be very, very difficult, even with the most wonderful package that the government can give on Help to Buy, and they've been announcing Help to Buy products. If you are in a short-term contract or minimum wage, there is just no way you'll get a mortgage. So I think the affordable housing question and the security question are very closely linked in the London elections. And I would say it's not just for black and ethnic minority members of the community, but it's across the piece. And that's actually something that's a positive thing, in that I think for the first time perhaps in a long time, the people in Muswell Hill perhaps, or in the west of the constituency, who are saying, I'm worried about housing because my children will not be able to look after me in my older age. And it's the same thing that perhaps people in Tottenham have been saying to David for a lot longer about, where's the security, where is my long-term future in our wonderful capital? And I think that really is something that should push us all out to vote, and that brings us together really, because we're all fighting on the same kind of platform around the affordability and the security question. So that's my sort of policy push for this upcoming election, and something which I think brings us together. The other thing I thought, which is a little bit unusual, something that I don't think anyone else has mentioned, is I'm involved in a group in Parliament, which is the all-party group for Chinese people in Britain, because if you look at representation in both the Lords and the Commons, and indeed on our local authorities, and even in the Assembly, and Joanne McCartney will tell me if I'm wrong, I don't think we have any Chinese on the Assembly at the moment. Some of you who have been around a while will remember Councillor Tay, looking at Narendra here. He used to be a councillor in Barnet. We had Mei Ling, who was in Lewisham, and a few others, but that's a very underrepresented group. And one of the things that we're trying to do cross-party, try and build up representation of Chinese people, which is a growing community. And the Haringey Chinese Association is holding their New Year Festival, which Sheila's going to on Tuesday to represent elected members there. And it is a growing group. And I feel that's sort of my passion, to try and see if I can assist to try and get more Chinese people elected. As I think Justin mentioned, Alan Mack is on the Tory benches, and I've invited Alan to our meetings, and I'm hoping he will come to one in the future. And that's something that I feel is a real push that we could all. So if any of you know active people in the community who might one day want to be involved, I see unfortunately there's no members here that I know of who are Chinese. That's something that I feel very strongly about, having lived in China for a short period. And I don't know whether there's anybody here who's from the Asia Pacific region, but that's something which I think we could perhaps all club together and think about how we can and push that one.
National living wage and food waste.
That's right.
Thank you.
And the living wage, which I mentioned briefly, but that's really the two things that I wanted to say very much, Seema, but just to say thank you for putting on today, and it's been great to have so many people here, so many high-profile Haringey colleagues across the piece, and I look forward to the upcoming months in the election and working together just to push, really, voting, and to push participation, and to fight against apathy, because I think that's something which sometimes when things feel pretty bleak, just getting people to vote is such an important aspect, and obviously registering people to vote, which I know that you've already covered today, but you know, just carrying around the little cards which say don't forget to register to vote. So I think people often just don't know how to vote, and they don't really, perhaps first-time voters as well, don't really know what you have to do when you walk into the polling station, perhaps in schools we should be doing a, this is how you vote. You walk into a polling station, you get a ballot paper and you mark an X next to the name or the party, just to basically educate people, because they're all slightly different elections as well. And I'm sure Joanne has gone through what her ballot paper will look like in a couple of short months' time. But you know, these things are important, the basics, because we, you know, have a lot of newly arrived communities who may have a different experience of voting as well. So any opportunities that you get to go into schools, take them up and talk to young people about voting. So I've always found the schools to be really enthusiastic about democracy, voting, and better representation for underrepresented groups. Thank you, Sam. We'll leave it there. Everybody's hungry.
I know that a lot of you follow us on Twitter, and if you don't, then please do, because I have monthly targets of getting Twitter followers. I don't want to have another person in Tottenham unemployed, so
What's the Twitter account?
It's the Selby Centre. Well, not the, it's just Selby, at Selby Centre or at Selby Trust. We've got two. In front of you, you have our annual report, which really explains a lot about what we do, and then you have our one-page document, which we kind of had a big meeting and somebody was drawing and we couldn't use it and put it all on one page, which we find really helpful to give out. Help yourself with some food. Over the next few months we'll be tweeting a lot about all of the stuff we've been doing on this campaign. It'd be great to kind of get a lot of retweets on that, and we'll also be having a hustings to talk about the challenges and the apathy that Catherine spoke about. So our hustings will be on the 20th of April. For those of you who came to our general election hustings, there was about 250 people there. We're expecting roughly about the same number. Sorry, Joanne and Ron, I don't know. But did I just say 20 people will come in just to make you say yes or something? We've had all of the candidates apart from UKIP confirm, and once we get that confirmation or enough time that we felt we'd give them to confirm, then the market's going to start mid-next week or the week after. Thank you all so much for coming. Please finish the food, because we wouldn't know what to do with it otherwise. We don't know what to do with it, so that would be really great. And the room is free for you guys to carry on mingling and get to know each other and find out
about... There's people who are hungry.
There are people who are hungry, and we can find out more about this fantastic head teacher of yours, Justin.
Okay. Okay, thank you guys. Thanks for joining us, and yeah, please keep tweeting this. Yeah, okay, good. Anyway, tweet this at Selby Center as well. And goodbye. Okay, see you later. Thank you.